pediatric palliative care for cancer. So we're dealing with children and adolescents with cancer. It's easier to just look at the general definition of palliative care. The same definition applies for kids and adults. Of course, there are variations in the way you apply it. So the goal of palliative care is to prevent and relieve suffering and support the best possible quality of life for patients and their families who are dealing with advanced life-threatening disease. Some palliative care specialists would define it as a way of treating patients with dignity. If it was cardiology, you don't need someone to stand in front of you and tell you what pediatric cardiology is. So now this one is very unusual because the definition talks about suffering, quality of life, dignity, and things like that. We're dealing with advanced life-threatening disease. More than likely, it's a life-limiting disease, a terminal disease, like cancer that's so advanced that you start thinking about hospice and palliative care. And then the question is, if the patient is going to die, and let's make it really concrete, if the patient's going to die in 1 month or 2 months, your child with advanced cancer about to die in 1 to 2 months, and the mom and the dad and the siblings are around him and they're dealing with this, and you feel like it's your responsibility to continue caring for your patient and the family, what do you need to do? Obviously, you cannot cure the patient because we just said the patient's terminal, about to die in 1 to 2 months. But maybe we can help the patient or the child enjoy those remaining 1 to 2 months of his life with his mom and his dad and his sibling. So how do we do that? We try to improve or optimize as much as we can his quality of life. If he's in pain, it would be better quality if we can decrease the pain. If he's throwing up a lot, then we can manage the nausea. If he cannot sleep, maybe you can do something about that. If he's depressed, he's sad all the time, or he's fearful, he's anxious, maybe we can do something about that. So we talked about the physical distress and the psycho-emotional distress. Or some of you might want to say we're trying to relieve or decrease some of the suffering. Of course, suffering is a big word. I mean, it's hard to define. But quality of life goes far beyond that. What's the point of not experiencing a lot of symptoms, but you're stuck at home, you can't even enjoy the things children would enjoy, or you can't even enjoy the things adolescents need in life. So quality of life might mean trying to get you more functional and mobile as much as possible. Just because somebody said you're about to die in 2 months, it doesn't mean you cannot go out, meet your friends, go to the mall, play with your siblings. Sometimes when we're talking about 6 months, we even help the child learn how to read and maybe go back to school. And of course, we say, why the heck are we going to do that? He's not going to graduate. He's not going to become a doctor. Why does he need to learn to read and things like that? Because children need that. And kids also feel better if things go back to as normal as possible, the way they used to live. Now, just to remind you, when we say palliative care, we're not just referring to cancer, which is a condition for which curative treatment is possible but might fail, or for which curative treatment is not possible and it's already life-threatening, like a really bad congenital heart. Palliative care applies to other things. And the key idea is it's a disease process that's causing a lot of suffering and a lot of quality of life issues. Conditions requiring intensive long-term treatment aimed at maintaining the quality of life. Progressive conditions which treatment is exclusively palliative after diagnosis. Or conditions involving severe non-progressive disability causing extreme vulnerability to health complications. You're dealing with a lot of suffering and significant impact on the quality of life. I know what you're thinking right now. I mean, just talking about it makes you feel depressed. You know, it feels so helpless, so hopeless, it's depressing. We need to do something about it, but what can we do as doctors and nurses? My answer to that is we all can continue caring for them. And what do you call that kind of caring? That's called pediatric hospice and palliative care. Okay, so now we're done with the definitions. It's about the very, very, very sick. And we have to relieve suffering, optimize quality of life, treat with dignity. Okay, that's nice to hear. That's nice to say. But what is it really? You know, quality of life, suffering. I mean, those are big words. And isn't that too ambitious? Those two words involve all sorts of things. We're not just talking about physical forms of suffering. Could be psychological forms of suffering, social forms of suffering, could be existential, spiritual forms of suffering. Even pre-adolescents, or even kids or adolescents would have existential and spiritual distress and suffering. To make it easy to understand, we'll just talk about a case. James is a 13-year-old patient with advanced, progressive, incurable cancer. He'll die in 1 to 2 months. What do James and his family, his mom, his dad, his 6-year-old kid brother need from us? What's the goal? We just said it. We try to lessen the suffering as much as we can. We cannot completely eliminate it. Nobody could. We'll try to optimize quality of life. We cannot bring it back to normal. Nobody could. And by doing so, we can also tell ourselves the reason why we're doing that is because every human being, whether or not they're incurable or curable, deserves to be treated with dignity. So what do we do now? When I talk about palliative care and introduce palliative care, I always use this. The Canadians developed this one, and it gives you an idea of the things you really need to think about. This also puts the symptom control and the decision-making, advanced care planning, DNR, DNI in its proper place. They're only part of one or two boxes. If you just focus on those things, you might not be doing a good job, or you might be making the situation worse, or you might not be giving them what they really need, or the more important things that they really need. Let's start with the disease management box. The prognosis, you sit down, you tell them the prognosis, you disclose things to them. We talk to the parents, of course. If James is still a kid, a minor, he cannot decide for himself. Of course, if he's an adolescent, it would also be harmful if we don't tell him anything, or if we don't get his opinion or assent if he's an adolescent. We talk about prognosis, we talk about life prolongation, possibly how much time they have left with each other. We talk about what palliative care is, things I just told you. More than likely, the family doesn't have a clue or doesn't know about end-of-life care or palliative care. And they might even have the idea that, you know, once the doctor cannot cure you, then that's the end of the story. You just have to go home and suffer through the entire thing. And so we have to explain to them, we're still going to take care of them, and this is what we're going to do. We need to prioritize, like, what orders or tests or medications can be afforded, what are really needed, what are not. It might be nice to provide this kid with a really high-end, very expensive nutritional supplement, but then you won't be able to buy everything else, or you won't be able to provide other things which are much, much more important than that. Beside it, you see physical symptom management, improvement of function, trying to make the dehydration go away, trying to make sure that the patient is drinking well, talking about tube feeding, talking about IV fluids, and things like that. Now, when we talk about end-of-life care and palliative care, I know symptom and pain management would be one of the first things that come to mind, which is very unfortunate because we really shouldn't over-medicalize end-of-life care. The pain and other physical symptoms are not the only things that we need to address. We have to have a balanced approach and right prioritization. Now, I'll just give you one table. There's lots of tables like this. It gives you an idea. For example, we're talking about someone who's about to die, you know, in a few days or in a few weeks. You might encounter one of these: pain, or shortness of breath, agitation, maybe a little bit of nausea, maybe not, or seizures, a lot of secretions, and the patient's too weak to clear the secretions. Think about dying as a progressive multi-organ failure. Progressively and surely, organ systems are giving out. So what happens when your cardiopulmonary system starts having problems? Well, you'll have shortness of breath. Pain can come from all sorts of places. I mean, it's almost universal, although it's not severe in some cases. If you have something growing inside your head, increased intracranial pressure will give you pain. If the cancer is all over your bones, that's very painful. If the cancer obstructed your GI tract, that causes a different form of pain. Agitation. If you're about to die, the circulation goes, oxygenation goes, especially if your parents have declined the use of intubation and ventilation. Even with intubation and ventilation, if the disease process is progressive, it would ultimately affect your oxygenation levels. It would ultimately affect your circulation. You might get seizures, you might get agitation, you might get delirium, nausea and vomiting, same thing. Near the end, all sorts of things are happening. You're not eating. You might get stress ulceration, stress gastritis. It might be that your cancer is blocked off your GI tract. You might be experiencing increased intracranial pressure, and you'll also be vomiting. These are medications that you're very, very familiar with. The general idea is you want to use just enough. You want to limit any potential side effect. But the most important thing is you want to use enough so that the patient is not in distress and the patient is comfortable. So you're trying to balance things out. Of course, I know very near the end, there's no way you can completely balance things out. Sometimes if the patient's about to die in the next 2 hours and he's terribly short of breath. He'll feel like he's drowning for the next 2 hours. And the only thing that would somewhat decrease that sensation would be morphine. You'd give it, right? I mean, we have data to prove that at this point, as long as you're using the right doses of morphine, you're not actually going to hasten death. Even if it does somewhat hasten death, what would you choose? 2 hours of terrible suffering or 1 hour and 30 minutes of relative comfort? So the rules change when you're dealing with someone who's clearly about to die and you cannot do anything about it. And these medications are the medications you already know about. Now, for the specialist, you might even be able to choose the best medication regimen. For example, somebody is nausea or vomiting. The initial reaction would be, well, give this patient an antiemetic, right? But then if you're the specialist and you know, this patient is nauseated and vomiting because there's something happening inside his head. Maybe intracranial pressure is increasing. Well, maybe it's partly because the GI tract is obstructed. Then you can say, well, instead of just choosing any antiemetic, maybe we can choose this one because this is centrally acting. You can say that. Or you can say, well, you know, if the mom is willing, we might be able to relieve the obstruction. I mean, especially if the kid still has 6 months or 8 months to go. So you can think of other things aside from these things that are listed here. This is just a general guide. Let's talk about secretions. Hyoscyamine. Well, if you have someone who's not yet about to die, but someone who's has like 4 months to go, but is so weak that he cannot clear his secretions, well, just suction the thing out regularly. That should do it. If it's down the throat area, just put the tube all the way down the throat. That would be 4 months of tube running down through your throat all the time. That's not great quality of life. Well, maybe you can dry out the secretions. We have a lot of medications whose side effect is drying out of secretions. If you do that, maybe you don't need to stick that tube all the way down the child's throat every 3 hours or every 4 hours. Death rattle. The death rattle would be somewhat related to secretions. If someone's about to die in the next few hours and he's so weak that he cannot clear his secretions, he's probably so out of it, he won't even feel the secretions running up and down his throat, and he's doing this rattly sound. That's why we call it death rattle. For this particular death rattle, so loud that his parents and his family all around him, they're holding vigil, he's about to die, hears this loud rattling sound. You have this family hearing this loud rattling sound and they have no idea what it is. Now, it would be a good idea if you can give something to decrease the secretions so that they're not going to be distressed and suffering through the entire ordeal while they're holding vigil, while they're waiting for the actual death to arrive. So we still do it. You also take care of the family members who are with the patient. Suffering is not only physical, it's also psychological or emotional. So always remember, children are also human beings, just like us adults. They react, they think, they feel sadness, anger, worry, fear, just like us. But they are not simply small versions of us. They think, feel, and need different things. They are not yet mature adults, and they need support from adults. Even adolescents are not yet mature adults. It's a very common mistake that we assume that there's no difference between a 30-year-old and a 16-year-old. So let's go back to James. He might be asking, why did God allow this to happen to me? Is there really heaven? What happens when I die? How come they're not listening to what I think and want? Or the adults, the doctors and the nurses and my parents, they just talk to each other. I know they're deciding for me. Don't I get a say? Well, you know, it's Gen Z. He might say, I Googled what I have and my medications and I know I have a really bad condition, and he guessed right that he'll die in a few months or he'll die in a few days, even without his parents and his doctors telling him. Like, what if he is 2 to 4 years old? We might ask, when people die, when do they wake up? And it's not because they are psychotic or there's something wrong with their brain. It's just that they're 2 to 4 years old, right? When I do bad things, I get punished. So that's why I'm sick. Guilt and anxiety. Or it might be that, you know, he's in the hospital, he's feeling all sorts of things. He has a lot of discomfort going on. Then he'll say, where's my mom? Where's my dad? He won't say, where's my doctor? Or he won't say, give me morphine. He'll say, where's my mom? And I'm scared. This is so uncomfortable. There's a lot of pain happening. Now, what if James is a baby? Now, we don't say, well, he's a baby, so who cares, right? So the baby's just there. He's not feeling anything. Nothing's happening with this baby. Well, guess what? There is. If the baby's experiencing a lot of discomfort and the baby's always comforted by the presence of his mom, and you take away the mom, you tell the mom, go buy this in the pharmacy, or, you know, go home and just get the nurses to take care of the baby, you might see a baby crying all night. just because the baby doesn't say it, if you watch the baby while you're doing all these procedures and poking all sorts of needles in his arm, I mean, you will see him flinch and wince. Now, when you look at the textbooks and the introductory articles on pediatric palliative care, you'll see this table. The reason why this table is presented is just to guide you. The way you approach or the way you comfort someone experiencing emotional difficulties or spiritual difficulties, especially if you're dealing with a pre-adolescent or an adolescent, will be guided by the child's cognitive, emotional, and spiritual development. We can't discuss everything about the social box, but you can see there it contains cultural values, beliefs, isolation, abandonment, intimacy, and rituals, and financial resources, all sorts of things. But we'll focus on the most important thing about that box, which would be the family, the psycho-emotional, psycho-social stuff about the family. Now, let's say James, he has his mom, his dad, his kid brother, his grandparents. He even has classmates in school. He's a teenager who was attending school before he got really sick. Now he's about to die in 1 to 2 months. His friends, his cousins, all these people are affected by James' illness. Even his classmates. If you look through more comprehensive approaches to palliative care, you would see suggestions about taking care or talking to the patient's classmates, especially if the patient has a terminal illness or especially if the patient's about or died or is about to die. You also take care of the people who will be affected. They will be affected while James is getting treatment, when James is dying, and after James dies. Now we go to the last three boxes. So again, there's several boxes. Don't forget that. Actually, if you don't take care of one box, you might cause problems with another box. Like if you have someone who's severely anxious and depressed, even if you have the perfect dose for the physical discomfort, you'll notice it's not working too well. James is going home. So how does he take a bath? Who's going to help him take a bath? Can he move about? Now, will someone be with him? How's the ventilation in his room, especially if he's bedridden already? Who's going to be his caregiver? If there's an emergency and nobody can be with him all the time, can we call for help? Okay, practical stuff. I mean, things that we sometimes don't think about since we're doctors or nurses. We say, well, you know, and that's not our job. But then the question is, whose job it is? Most of the time, if we don't pay attention to it, nobody would. We can talk about where he dies. Does he die in the hospital or does he die at home? Which would be best for him? If he's going to die at home, most of the time, people die in relative comfort. There's no huge pain crisis or there's no big seizure or delirium problem. Yeah, that only probably happens 1 or 2 out of 10 cases. But sometimes we're not sure if it's going to happen or not. So what if it happens? Who's going to be there? If he starts having seizures because he already had one before he went home from the hospital, who's going to be handling the seizure? Maybe we should teach the parents or whoever is going to be with James what to do. We should tell them that might happen so that they don't get too stressed about it. Probably teach them what to do. It's going to be too late if you just call the nurse and the nurse takes 30 minutes to get there, right? Or what if it's something that keeps on bleeding and we can't do anything about it? You know, like a very huge fungating mass and, you know, we've done everything. We've irradiated the area and it was so weak for anything more aggressive than that. Who's going to be there when things start bleeding more or when James bleeds out? Can they handle it at home or should they be in the hospital? Should we put a nurse there all the time? So these are the things that we think about and much, much more. When James dies, we still have to make sure that the grieving loved ones are well cared for. If the grief and the bereavement problem is so severe, we have to make sure that they can call us and we can suggest courses of action, or at least, especially if you're in a country or a community with very limited healthcare resources, you should be able to provide some basic grief support or bereavement problem support. Or maybe you should try to ask around, are there bereavement services in the hospital? Are there bereavement services in your community? Maybe in the church, if you're in a community or dealing with a family with limited resources, you know, sometimes you have to be creative and you have to prepare in advance. Now, lastly, it would be spiritual. Spiritual distress can be a sense of lack of meaning, could be existential. You know, you're facing death and you feel isolated. The family feels isolated. All their friends don't have dying kids. And then their friends call them up and say a few words to support them, but really they feel alone. Death causes a lot of existential distress. Actually, not just for our teenage patient. His parents, his sibling. I mean, if his brother can die, so can he, right? Even the doctors and nurses would experience existential distress because they too can die. And looking at James reminds them what can happen to them or what can happen to their child if they have kids, especially those same age as James, right? Now that I showed you how big and complicated and difficult it looks like, so how do we do it? My suggestion is just consider this basic stuff. What's the setting? What's the context? What do we have? What resources do we have? If we don't have resources for a lot of manpower, who can do this or who can do that? Maybe for this part, the senior resident can do this. Adolescent medicine can be part of this one. You might need to mobilize the nurses. I mean, don't just do everything yourselves. This is a lot of things. Call social work. Maybe they can provide us with one and we can send her through some training and maybe they can do this, this, and this, right? Child life. If we cannot hire, maybe we can give our residents basic training on child life and how to communicate with small kids or how to support small kids. Don't forget pastoral care. Let's talk to the priest or the pastor. Let's have some kind of protocol or procedure. When do we call them up? Okay, how much can they do? And as far as knowledge base is concerned, like, you know, you're the doctor, of course, you want to have a good handle on things, especially the things that need your prescription and things that feels like it's very clinical and it's really your job to do it. There's lots of information available. Online training programs abound. Pediatric palliative care has been around for a few decades now, and it seems like it's going to grow separately compared to adult palliative care. The original hospice and palliative care started with adults. And then after a few years, the pediatricians are saying, you know, you can't just treat kids like adults. I mean, they're different. Of course, they're different. We just discussed how different they are. Right now, it looks like pediatric palliative care is going to be a separate field under pediatrics. So there are textbooks, there are workshops, and most of these things are very easy to understand. Like I said, your actual patients don't need a lot of drug prescriptions from you. What they need is a lot of effort and caring on your part. Let's stop with a very famous quote from Cicely Saunders. She was a nurse taking care of dying people in halfway houses for the dying, and most of them are patients with cancer. And she founded the modern hospice movement. And she says, "You matter because you are you. You matter to the end of your life, and we will do all we can not only to help you die peacefully, but also to live until you die."